Good morning. Welcome to worship and welcome to peace. Today is a commemoration day in the church. Today we remember Martin Luther King Jr. He is remembered as an American prophet of justice among races and nations. He was a pastor in churches in Montgomery, Alabama and Atlanta, Georgia. He preached nonviolent action for racial equality and demanded that love be returned for hate. He received the Nobel Prize for Peace in 1964 and was killed by an assassin on April the 4th, 1968. We honor Martin Luther King today as a martyr for the Christian faith and a renewer of society. Thank you for joining us today. We gather near and far, as we always do, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community living out Christ's justice in the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Gracious God, in every age, you have sent men and women who have given their lives in witness to your love and truth. Inspire us with the memory of your servant Martin Luther King, Jr., whose faithfulness led to the way of the cross. And give us courage to bear full witness with our lives to your Son's victory over sin and death, for he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." Here ends the reading.
Good morning, everyone. When I was young, like you, I remember a song from Vacation Bible School. Maybe you know it. It's called "Jesus Loves the Little Children." It goes like this. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. And that song taught me this. People are different and people are equal. We are different. We have different color skin, red and yellow, black and white, different color hair. Some people are tall, some people are short. We're different. And I love that people are different. I think you do too. And here's how I know. Would you like to look like me? Or would you want everyone to look like me? Would you want to be bald, no hair up here? I don't think so. Differences are great. That people look different, that kids look different, is a gift of God to you and to me. Yes, people are different, and we are all also equal. How? We are all equal in that God loves you exactly. God loves you and everyone exactly the way you are. Different and equal. It's that song again. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. You are precious to Jesus, just the way you are.
The gospel comes from Matthew, the 5th chapter. Jesus said, "You have heard it that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord. Well, this weekend, we celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. Dr. King lived his life to honor the gospel of Jesus Christ, and in action that meant the pursuit of civil rights for all people by means of nonviolent protest and civil disobedience. I've often wondered what Dr. King would say today in response generally to the last decade of racial injustice, to the summer's civil rights demonstrations in specific, and especially to the January 6th insurrection at our nation's capital. Born in 1929, King would have turned 92 years old this weekend, January 15th. And many of you lived your lives alongside his until that tragic day when he was taken too soon. Thankfully, though, as I wonder about what he would say, I don't have to wonder very hard. In April 1963, a few months before his famous I Have a Dream speech on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, as part of the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, King had organized and participated in marches and sit-ins in Birmingham, Alabama. The movement was met with fierce pushback, especially from white government and religious leaders. As King and so many others fought against segregation, against inequality, against police brutality, against white supremacy, things we're still fighting against now. They believed his methods to be unwise and untimely, as they called it. His way wasn't the right way to protest. It'd be better to wait till later. And so a group of 8 white interdenominational leaders from Alabama called on King to end the campaign in an open letter they entitled, A Call for Unity. They wrongly believed that King's demonstrations were creating division rather than a pathway to freedom and equal rights. In response, King wrote a letter to them in return. Having been arrested for his leadership in the protests and civil rights demonstrations, he penned them a letter from a Birmingham jail. His words from this letter nearly 60 years ago are just as applicable now in this second civil rights era as they were then. While there have no doubt been advancements and improvements in our society, too much has still stayed the same. And so as a congregation that belongs to the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, one of the whitest denominations in the United States, where nearly 96 of us identify as white, let us humbly consider and take heart that Dr. King's words are meant for us just as they were meant for those clergy. King, having been accused of being an unwelcome outsider in the Birmingham community, began his letter from a Birmingham jail by reminding his dissidents that he was there because injustice was there, and that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. He then laments that the clergyman complained against his tactics of nonviolent protest rather than the reason he was protesting in the first place. King writes, "You deplore the demonstrations that are presently taking place in Birmingham, but I am sorry that your statement did not express a similar concern for the conditions that brought the demonstrations into being. It is even more unfortunate that the white power structure of this city left the black community with no alternative." As people of empathy, if the situation arises when we don't understand or agree with the actions of another, we're called to ask why and step into their shoes. All too often, we focus on ourselves rather than our neighbors and the ways that our actions hurt them. As this summer fatefully reminded us, there are still unjust systems that unfairly discriminate against our nation's Black and BIPOC neighbors and siblings, that reinforce the prejudices and biases of individuals. One example of this prejudice was discussed in our fall small group on the book Me and White Supremacy. It's the issue of colorblindness. The notion that if we could decide to stop seeing race, well, then racism goes away. Sometimes we try so hard to prove that we're not racist that we deny it exists. It's often heard through phrases like, "I don't see color." Sometimes it comes from a good place, and we quote Dr. King's I Have a Dream speech when he wished people would be judged by the content of their character, not the color of their skin. But colorblindness is a gross twisting on those words, because when we do that, we ignore the diversity instead of celebrating it, and we stop ourselves from resolving our own white supremacy. King continues his letter saying, "You may well ask, why direct action? Why sit-ins, marches, etc.? Isn't negotiation a better path?" You're exactly right in your call for negotiation. Indeed, this is the purpose of direct action. Nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and establish such creative tension that a community that has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issues. Protests like the ones we saw and participated in this summer are effective because they give voice to voices that are often unheard. And being nonviolent, expressing love for neighbor and cause, the tension they create helps us to rise from the dark depths of prejudice and racism to the majestic heights of understanding and brotherhood, as King states. The tension creates the path for negotiation, the policy change, for the broken systems to be remade. "But why now?" the clergy cried. "Can't it wait?" King responds, "We have not made a single gain in civil rights without determined legal and nonviolent pressure. History is the long and tragic story of the fact that privileged groups seldom give up their privileges voluntarily. We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. For years now, I have heard the words, wait. This wait has almost always meant never." I think we have this idea in our heads that things will automatically just work out for the better. That if we hope for something, then it will come true. But true hope is not just mere optimism, but the willingness to put in the work to make that hoped for outcome come true. "For justice too long delayed is justice denied," King states. Think about it. Time can work constructively or destructively. Sometimes time allows us to process and think clearly. Other times it can mean grave missed opportunities. If we think about it in terms of the coronavirus pandemic, time has given us the chance to create a vaccine. But the more time that passes, the more people pass away as well. As the church, as we think about time, we have the responsibility and the call not just to respond to injustice, but to be proactive in working for justice too. Because the time is always ripe to do right. Because there is never a convenient time to decry oppression, to wait until the tension decreases. There's never a better time. The best time is always now. As King states, "Now is the time to lift our national policy from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of human dignity." King's next section talks about the law. He writes, "One may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others?" The answer is found in the fact that there are two types of laws. There are just and there are unjust laws. I would agree with St. Augustine that an unjust law is no law at all. Any law that uplifts human personality is just. Any law that degrades human personality is unjust. King had segregation specifically in mind when he said this. At that time, segregation was legal. But King states, segregation is not only politically, economically, and sociologically unsound, but it is morally wrong and sinful. Similarly, early Christians and followers of Jesus were persecuted. At that time, saying, "Jesus is Lord," was an incredibly overt statement against Caesar. Because if Jesus was Lord, Caesar was not. And Caesar demanded loyalty above all else and punished those who defied him. It was the reason Jesus was put to the cross. In the United States, our society has always had unjust laws, because here laws have always been enacted mostly by powerful white men. in the 116th Congress of the United States, our most recent Congress containing the Senate and the House of Representatives, around 88% were Christian, even though the Pew Research Center found only 70% of the U.S. to identify so. In the House of Representatives, which has become more consistently similar to the U.S. population demographically, about 72% were white, but only 23% were women. In the Senate, the U.S. is not represented well demographically. Out of 100 senators, only 26 were women and 91 were white. It is our duty to elevate laws and elect officials that uplift human personality and diversity. This brings us to King's largest section of the letter, where he speaks directly to whom he calls the white moderate. He writes, "The great stumbling block in the stride toward freedom is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I can't agree with your methods of direct action." King's biggest disappointment is not with those who lit their torches in Charleston or those who raided the Capitol. They've shown their true colors. His biggest disappointment is in those who have stayed silent, stayed complicit in times of challenge and controversy. King continues, "I had hoped that the white moderate would understand that law and order exists for the purpose of establishing justice, and that when they fail to do this, they become dangerous structural dams that block the flow of social progress. As a people, we need to decide what we are devoted to. Do we prefer the absence of conflict or the presence of justice?" And then King says, "We will have to repent in this generation, not merely for the vitriolic words and actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence of the good people." And finally, King leaves us with an invitation. Throughout his time leading the civil rights movement, King was considered an extremist. The word had and still has negative connotation. When we think of extremists, we often think of people who are violent, people who use their influence to create chaos and to spread hatred. When I saw the insurrectionists who stormed the Capitol, I was dismayed by the giant cross that was erected, by the signs stating Jesus saves and God bless America. Meanwhile, incredible damage was done. Lives were lost. I used to think that saying, "Oh my God," was taking the Lord's name in vain. But seeing those idolatrous images of white Christian nationalism reminded me of what taking the Lord's name in vain truly looks like. These people were extremists in hate. Alternatively, King calls us to be extremists in love. "Was not Jesus an extremist in love?" he says. "Love your enemies, bless them that curse you, pray for them that despite you. Was not Amos an extremist for justice? Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. Was not Martin Luther an extremist? Here I stand, I can do no other. So help me God." The question is not whether we will be extremists, but what kind of extremists we will be. Will we be extremists of hate or extremists of love? Will we be extremists for the preservation of injustice, or will we be extremists for the cause of justice? As King reminds us of the words that Jesus stated from his Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel of Matthew, we're left with this scandal of grace. Anyone can love those closest to them. Anybody can do that. But those who follow Jesus are called to something greater. We're called to love not just our family, our friends, our neighbors, but those we don't like, those we disagree with, those we would consider our enemy as well. That is the way that God loves, unconditionally, eternally, no matter what. Through all of his trials and triumphs, King envisioned a better future, a future echoed in the words of Isaiah. A voice cries out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." There is great work left to do in the effort for racial justice and a more perfect world. It is work that requires grace and humility. It is work that requires courage and accountability. It is work that requires empathy and reparation. It is work that moves us from self-preservation to wholeness and jubilation. And so I leave you, as King left his letter, with this prayer. Let us all hope that the dark clouds of racial prejudice will soon pass away, and the deep fog of misunderstanding will be lifted from our fear-drenched communities in some not-too-distant tomorrow. And in some not-so-distant tomorrow, the radiant start of love and brotherhood will shine over our great nation with all of their scintillating beauty. Amen.
Thank you.
Confident that God hears us when we pray, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. I will conclude each petition with, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you to respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray. God of mercy, this day we pray for justice. As we remember Dr. King, let us not forget all that he and so many others worked so hard for. And so we lift up to you all who are persecuted, all who are oppressed, all who are unable to enjoy the full benefits of freedom. Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all people, we pray for our nation. In this time of turmoil and fear, remind us of your constant presence. Guide leaders with wisdom and care. Grant us peace, not just a peace absent of conflict, but a peace that is full of justice. And help us, we pray, to love our neighbors, all of them, even the ones we might consider to be enemies. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing, we pray for those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Restore those who are sick, those affected by the virus. Grant resilience and hope to the anxious, the lonely, the exhausted, and the broken. And we ask that you comfort all in need of your care. Today, we especially pray for John, for Marilyn and Pat, for Kelsey and John, for Dawn and Daryl, for the Bringold family as they mourn the death of Pat. Grant them all comfort, grant them relief, grant them hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, you hear our prayers even before we speak them. Receive them for the sake of the one through whom you have revealed your goodness, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In Jesus Christ, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Reverend Thomas Dorsey wrote today's closing hymn in the wake of the tremendous loss of his wife and child. Through his grief, he cried out to God and was struck by this melody and lyrics. The tune became Martin Luther King Jr.'s favorite hymn, one he turned to for hope during troubled times. It was often sung at civil rights rallies, and it was so loved that it was also sung at Dr. King's funeral. May it grant us hope this day. The hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Precious Lord, take my hand.
Now may God the Creator strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved fill you, and the Holy Spirit you in peace. Amen. Go in peace and be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.